Losing a loved one is hard enough, and just the thought of them coming back, and of course sucking the blood of another person, maybe even their own family, is hard to comprehend. Today, it seems unbelievable to us. We say it's just a legend. However, is it really just a legend? Everyone, this is Elizabeth again, and thank you so much for coming to our channel, Explore the Unknown. You don't miss out any new videos every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. With Halloween coming up soon, I'll be going over crimes that took place on Halloween night, and of course, the legends of the scary date of October 31st. Whether you're crafting your own DIY vampire costume or choosing the one that you buy at a store, from sexy vampires to silly vampire costumes, add your own vampire makeup. It's just fun to wear a cape while you're happily hunting for favorite candy every Halloween, or just going for an adult Halloween party and scare your friends with real life costumes. While even the most vampire admirers recognize vampires as fictional beings, there was a time when people had real life fears about falling into prey to those children of the night. Now, long ago, this was a real fear. For the real vampire enthusiast to get the real feel of vampirism, even a booming vampire tourist industry, if you've got money and inclination to travel to Romania and of course beyond, you'd be set. However, you don't have to go very far. It has been noted to be here even in the States. Throughout the centuries, there have been a number of vampire scares, often tied to widespread diseases like the European disease or misunderstood physical deformities. Real-life vampires of New England is the legend of real bloodsuckers and the violence upon their corpses. They thought that they would have just a disease. The vampire scares usually began when a person that had died and others in the vicinity began dying too, usually with the same kind of sickness. Now, more than a century ago, vampires stalked the Rhode Island and the New England farms, would dig up the relatives thinking that they were vampires, and they would desecrate them in an effort to protect the living. Then later, there was vampire hunters that they thought that could remove and burn their loved ones' hearts just to stop them from coming back to life. And they would rebury them. Now, the modern scholars would unearth the real stories of these vampires whose tragedies underlie the classic like of Dracula. It began in Eastern Europe and spread through the Western countries, France, England, in the 1700s. And then, to stop the rule of New England, where the vampire panic were very common in the late 1800s, particularly in Rhode Island. Vampire scares usually began when a person had died from a contagious disease. New England was well known for having tuberculosis and of course other sicknesses. People began dying, usually from the same sickness. Maybe it was ignorance of the germs. People surmised that the dead person or loved one had come back to drain the family member's blood. They had done various methods so that they would not be harmed, the community, or other people. They were called the vampire hunters. Now, the hunters were not disappointed when they pried open the graves of many that had natural signs of decay, like bloating and bleeding. There were many people or loved ones that was just accused of being bloodsuckers due to the natural causes of decay. Like Peter Palaswitz, he had been exhumed and staked through his heart only weeks after his death in 1725. And there were others, like Arnold Perlow. It was in the early 18th century. He broke his neck after falling from a hay wagon. He was accused of vampirism and was exhumed after a series of the deaths in his village. And many of his supposed victims were dug up too. He was the first victim to die in his village of the sickness. Subsequently, locals' deaths were blamed on his late night outings. A rather gruesome surrounding autopsy revealed what were considered to the telltale signs of vampirism. One witness wrote, "The hair and beard had grown on him. The older skin, which was somewhat whitish, had peeled away, and new flesh, one had emerged under it. Not without astonishment, I saw some flesh blood in his mouth," he said. The Australian military authorities was in control of that region and investigated the deaths. They had published account was widely circulated that spreading the vampire superstition to Western Europe, it had taken hold and even reached to the New World. Then there is Natalie Vaughn. She was just 19 years old. She had been buried in 1889. She is almost as famous as Mercy Brown, whose examination was covered by the international newspapers. Now, Vaughn Cemetery has been visited by many and also vandalized, and her headstone broken into pieces. The superstition probably came about in the late half century or so, may have been result of confusion with Mercy, who died nearby at a similar date and of course age. Frederick Ransom was a college student from a well-respected family in South Woodstock, Vermont. He had died of tuberculosis in 1817. He was known to be an educated person, but was ensnared in the vampire panic that was taking place at that time. His father had his body exhumed in the hopes of saving the rest of his family. So Frederick's heart was burned in the blacksmith forge. However, it did not prove the remedy of Frederick's mother and sister, or his two brothers that died right afterwards. Ransom's surviving brother, Daniel, later wrote, "It has been related to me that there was a tendency in our family to consumption and that I would die with it before I was 30. Now, when Daniel Ransom wrote these words, he was more than 80 years old at the time. A Native American man named Bristow Conjon. He had several children who had died of tuberculosis in Rhode Island in the 1800s. The body of one of his children that had died and was exhumed, the child's vital parts was burned because of the superstition. Though it was not entirely clear if the Bristow's family was African American or American Indian, the case was found out that vampire tradition crossed racial lines. Then there was Annie Dennett. She had died from consumption of tuberculosis at the age of 21 years old in the rural New Hampshire. A Free Will Baptist minister from Vermont named Enoch Hayes went to her exhumation, where her family took as a ditch effort to save Annie's father, who also had tuberculosis. Enoch had an entry in his diary, a minister of the vampire hunt, at the time wrote, "They opened the grave, and it was a solemn sight indeed." He wrote, "A young brother by the name of Adams examined the moldy spectacle, but found nothing, as they supposed they should have. There was but a little left except the bones." A lot of legends seem to be out of the family's corpses that has contagious disease and misunderstandings of how bodies decompose. Also, what they died of. Today, some of the more prevalent vampire myths can be explained by science. The fear came long ago that the dead could still harm the living was only intensified when dead bodies were exhumed and appeared to have blood coming out of their mouths. Without an understanding of how the body decomposes and was known as a purge fluid, it's easy to see how they would assume that their loved ones had come back from the dead and were drinking people's blood. Many early skeletons from medieval times have been found with bricks or even rocks filling their mouths or sickles around their necks, all the better to prevent their loved ones from being raised up and being attacked. Now, the condition that one craves blood from energy is real. It's also known as hepatomania. It's very real. The difference is that these people drink from willing donors and not from hunting them or sucking the blood from their necks. These real vampires are real, and they're real people with unusual tastes. Some often live with others like themselves in communities and are very private, so they're not confused with the ones that want to take out the steak knives or the garlic and the silver bullet with the organizations like Atlanta's Vampire Alliance popping up. There's growing advocacy for those that pursue this lifestyle. So do you think there's real vampires out there in this world? Or are you one of the ones that think from the 1800s just think it's just a misunderstanding of how body decomposes? Tell me your thoughts on this and be kind and respectful in the comments, guys. Thank you so much for coming and being here with me today. Until our next video, God bless and bye.